The research interests of Francisco Robles include science, philosophy, and literature in colonial Latin America, and the relationship between literary production and knowledge of the 17th and 18th centuries. After completing his first book manuscript, entitled A New World for the Republic of Letters, Polemics, Literature, and Knowledge in 18th Century Mexico, he has dedicated himself to exploring connections between early modern poetry and natural philosophy in the Hispanic world.
Hello, I'm Jose Francisco Robles. I'm a member, a faculty member of the Spanish and Portuguese Studies Department here at the University of Washington, and I specialize in colonial Latin American literature and cultures with an emphasis on the 18th century. And in fact, my first book, which will be published in 2020, is devoted to a study in 18th century Mexico and the polemics about knowledge production and scholarly networks during that era. I divided my book in three parts. The first part, I explore how the scholarly networks were forming in Mexico during that moment, by means of which scholars trying to establish in the viceroyalty of Mexico a new understanding of literature and a new understanding on the intellectual history of the country. And that was made especially by the publication of periodicals and bibliographies, and with a particular interest in rescuing the past, the pre-Columbian past of Mexico, and the present under the power of the Creole government, or no government, but the Creole society. In the first part of my book, when I established these networks, I'm very interested in exploring how the first journalists in Mexico, they were very interested in examining not only the everyday life of Mexico, but also the power of the authorities on this daily life in the viceroyalty. And likewise, the writing of bibliographies during the first time, the first half of the century, was a very interesting very interesting aspect of the literary culture of the viceroyalty, because by means of these bibliographies, scholars were able to rescue the past, the colonial past, not only from the text written during the 18th century, but also from the 16th to the 17th century too. So by means of this, these scholars trying to establish a tradition, a scholarly tradition in the viceroyalty, and at the same time to contest what we're saying about the intellectual history in the Americas from Europe. Many European scholars during that era, they see no knowledge production in the Americas and no any kind of development during the colonial era in the New World. And that is why Mexico is a very important viceroyalty during that moment, because they were the first in order, the first in trying to challenge that vision of the New World. And they established that by means of the publication of books devoted to the intellectual culture of the viceroyalty. In the second part of my book, I'm examining how Mexican scholars rescue the pre-Columbian past, how they reinterpret the past in order to offer a sort of view of the pre-Columbian world as a first scholarly republic of letters in the viceroyalty. So that is very important, because they interpret codices, for example, they interpret the different traditions during the pre-Columbian era, and they also, for example, took the figure of Nezahualcóyotl as the first intellectual in Mexico. So that is why in this second part, examine the development of this interpretation of the past. But they also interpreted the present under the Criollo culture. And in this way, they trying to emphasize how Criollos have learned their lessons from Europe in order to understand their own past. And that is why they trying to publish more newspapers, more bibliographies, in order to put together all this tradition coming from Europe, but now under Criollo's culture, reshaped under a new idea that it's Mexico is one of the centers of the Republic of Letters in the world, and not just like another territory in the Americas. That is why in the third part of my book, this is the last part of my book, and I explore how scientific knowledge played a very important role in this rescue of the past, but also in the present. They published, Mexican scholars published scientific periodicals, but in many of these scientific periodicals, they also rescued the pre-Columbian past in order to understand this past from a scientific point of view, in order to explain how, for example, the two stones found in Mexico City in 1791 were so important for the Mexican culture and very important for the Republic's letters at large. So they found these two stones. One is lesser known, is the Coatlicue stone, the sculpture, and the second one is the, probably the most important of all of them. It's the sandstone, which is sometimes known as the Calendario Azteca, which is not a calendar properly, but it looks like a calendar. That is very important. By means of these discoveries, scholars, they're trying to put together this kind of very big puzzle, which was Mexican culture during the pre-Columbian era, and trying to understand what happened in the country and what is the legacy of this past in our present. So in this way, what they were trying to do was to discover their own Criollo present under the Spanish rule, but at the same time, they're trying to make connections between their present, the Spanish, Hispanic present, with the pre-Columbian past. This is my book in a few words. But I have a second project, which is devoted to, it's not entirely different from this first book, but it's devoted to the exploration of the relationship between poetry and science in the 17th and 18th centuries in the Hispanic world. So this project, I entitled this project like A Poetic Cabinet of Wonders, Early Modern Hispanic Poetry and the Making of Knowledge, because I'm just as a preliminary research, which I'm doing in this moment, and I'm focused on this different aspect of poetry during the first years of the 17th century to the last years of the 18th century, and the connections between the scientific endeavors, for example, in natural philosophy, and how natural philosophy used a lot of metaphors and allegories, poetic metaphors, to explain different phenomena. Poetry, meanwhile, did practically the same in order to explain the cosmos and the natural phenomena in during that era. So I took several examples from Mexico, for example, in the works of Sor Juana Inés de la Cruz. Also, I'm very interested in Sandoval Zapata's poetry, especially the sonnets. I'm also drawing upon the ideas on nature by Juan Ignacio Molina, a Chilean poet, historian, a biologist, who wrote a very interesting book devoted to the smallpox. It's probably one of the first self-pathographies, poetical self-pathographies in the Americas, which is entitled The Peste Variolarum. So it's a poetical exploration of the smallpox that he was suffering during that time, and he almost died because of this very terrible and horrible sickness. So sickness is another specific interest, one of my specific interests too in this poetry, because my meaning of sickness, poets who were sick and writing these poems, they explored this natural philosophy incarnated in their own bodies, like trying to combat these sicknesses and trying to fight against what they thought were the origin of the sicknesses. So that is why I'm trying to make this connection and put together this other puzzle, was not the pre-Columbian past, but it's the present, in the early modern present, and the relationship between natural philosophy and poetry. Thank you.